Lord, we thank you for your incredible consistency and ever-present presence in our life. We thank you that you hear our prayers. We thank you that you guide us in prayer. We thank you that you give us all things in Christ Jesus. Help us to see more clearly who he is and who we are in Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen. So we've been in this little series about David. David being the only person in the Bible that God said was a man after his own heart. And so it begs a question, is what does it mean to be a man after God's own heart? Because God didn't say that about anybody else in the Bible. He didn't say that about Moses. He didn't say that about Samuel. He didn't say that about Elijah. He didn't say that about John the Baptist. He didn't say that about any of the, what we might consider important people in the Bible. But he said it about David. And we talked about how David, as a young man, a shepherd, he had such a deep relationship with the Lord and such trust in the Lord that he didn't have a problem going and attacking and killing a bear and a lion who stole his sheep. He didn't have a problem as just a young man with a stone and a slingshot of going up against a 9-foot-tall warrior and taking him down. I mean, David had such confidence in the Lord that he knew that it didn't matter how big the obstacle, that David could overcome it. In fact, we read the Psalms that said he made his hands for battle, his fingers for war. I mean, David assumed that any attributes that he had were God-given, and he was always quick to acknowledge that and praise the Lord for it. And it's really kind of interesting. After David ended up slaying Goliath, you know, he comes under persecution from Saul because King Saul, the first king of Israel, is jealous of David because of hearing the song that the women were singing. Saul has killed his thousands, but David's killed his 10,000s. And Saul became very, very jealous of David and kept trying to kill him. But in the middle of all that, it's interesting to see the kind of dealings that God had with David, because in the middle of all that, David was finding favor with everybody. This Proverbs 16:7 says, when a man's ways please the Lord, he makes even his enemies to be at peace with him. There is just something about having the favor of the Lord that somebody who may hate you will end up praising you because of the influence that God has over them. Listen, David was a top-notch warrior, so his men loved him. Saul's daughter, Michal, loved him. Saul's son, Jonathan, loved him like he loved himself. In fact, Jonathan, they were such close friends that Jonathan made a covenant with him. He gave him his robe, his tunic, his sword, his bow, and his belt. For a king's son to do that, that meant something. See, in that era, when a new king came to power, oftentimes he would kill the family of his predecessor so he didn't have any upcoming rivals or any vendetta. So Jonathan obviously had an incentive, if he was just somebody who wanted to survive, to tell David a lie about what his father's intents were toward David about whether, you know, Saul wanted to kill him or not. But Jonathan didn't lie. He no doubt had heard that David was anointed by Samuel, the prophet, the same prophet that anointed Saul as king, anointed David as king. No doubt Jonathan heard about it. No doubt he, as a child of a monarch, would be concerned about whether he was going to live or die once Saul was no longer king. But I don't think that was Jonathan's motivation for befriending David. I think he just genuinely had an affection for the guy, even to the point where he covenanted with him, where their families would protect each other. Jonathan loved David. God gave him favor. In fact, there was even a time when Saul tried to get Jonathan to kill David. But Jonathan went to David and said, look, you hide until I talk to my dad. Jonathan goes and talks to Saul. Saul obviously wants to kill David. But Jonathan reminds him, he's like, you know, do you remember how jubilant you were and grateful that David came along and killed the giant that was taunting the army? And so Jonathan was able to talk Saul out of killing David. So Jonathan tells David, and David comes back into the house of the king. What David did in the house of King Saul was he played his harp, and that soothed a tormenting spirit that often came on Saul. that tormenting spirit was sent by God, which is an interesting discussion for a later time. But remember, God had pulled his anointing off of Saul, and he anointed David as king, and God was going to uproot and basically vanquish Saul and his entire family from ever being in the monarchy again in Israel. So David goes back to the house. He's playing Saul's house. He's playing his harp, soothing Saul's spirit. Another tormenting spirit came on Saul, and Saul once again tried to pin David with his javelin. David manages to escape, and then he's on the run. And of course, we already talked about how Saul would set his men to watch David's house so that they could catch him in his sleep and kill him. I mean, Saul was out to kill David, and David knew it. But here's something to remember in the middle of all that. David remembered the Lord was his defense and his refuge, and he constantly turned to the Lord. He knew that God, not only would God deliver, but God was able to allow David to rest in that deliverance. See, we need to remember that too. In the middle of the stuff that goes on in our world, God will defend us. He will deliver us. He will show us mercy. And then we can rest in that. And when we rest in that, we can remind ourselves of his deliverance, of his protection, of his rest, and we can praise him for it. That's what David was quick to do. That's why most of the Psalms were Psalms that David wrote. They were recollections of how God protected him, delivered him, gave him rest, gave him strength, was always with him. Now, in the midst of all that, David is still human. I mean, that's the thing that I think is really telling about David. He's just as human as the rest of us. He was afraid of Saul. He kept running from Saul. So obviously, he wasn't this so-called spiritual giant, not in the sense that we would classify one. A man who could stand up to a 9-foot-tall warrior and kill a bear and a lion, you'd think wouldn't have any issues dealing with King Saul. But the deal was, King Saul was God's anointed as far as David was concerned, and David wasn't going to retaliate at all. He feared the Lord too much. So anyway, when he finally escapes from Saul this last time, he goes to Naoth, where Samuel was, and then he later found Jonathan and pleaded with him about what he had done to make Saul want to kill him. So they came up with a plan. The next day, from this conversation, was what was called the New Moon Festival, and all of Saul's men were to eat at the festival at his table. And Jonathan and David tells Jonathan, look, if Saul asks you why I'm not there, just let him know that I'd ask you for permission to go to Bethlehem to celebrate the feast with my family. And if Saul's fine with that, then it's okay. Saul's not trying to kill me. But if he gets mad because I'm not there, that's a sign that Saul wants to kill me. So that's exactly what Jonathan did. And sure enough, David didn't show up at the feast. Saul asked Jonathan, he wasn't there the first day. Saul didn't say anything. But the second day of the feast, he noticed that David wasn't there. So he asked Jonathan, where's David? Jonathan tells him, I gave him permission to go celebrate the feast with his family in Bethlehem. Saul is outraged. He's so outraged that he throws a spear at his own son Jonathan to try to kill him. I mean, it's really telling, you know, what jealousy can do to somebody. I mean, it drove Saul to the point that he tried to kill his own son because of the fear and jealousy of David. Jealousy brings fear. So Jonathan goes and tells David, and they weep together because of the closest of friends. And here's what Jonathan tells David at that time. In 1 Samuel 20:42, he says, then Jonathan said to David, go in peace, since we have both sworn in the name of the Lord, saying, may the Lord be between you and me and between your descendants and my descendants forever. So he arose and departed, and Jonathan went into the city. So see, Jonathan cut that covenant with David the covenant would be not only between them, but also between their descendants. Look at the love that Jonathan had for David and David had for him, and the strength and courage that came with it. I mean, Jonathan's dad was the king who hated David because he thought David was going to usurp the throne And Jonathan would never be king, and Jonathan loved David so much he didn't care. He knew David was going to be king. He just loved David. And he was doing everything he could to protect him. That's love. Where jealousy brings fear, love brings strength and courage. I think that's important to remember sometimes, especially in the church. I think sometimes, especially people who want to be spiritual, sometimes might get a little jealous of somebody who they think is. And that's unfortunate because, guys, we all put our pants on the same way. We're all normal, and we're all fallible. We're all human, no matter how God uses us. But there may be other more unsavory reasons we're jealous, but I'm telling you, jealousy brings fear. If we're just loving each other like John commanded that we do, like Jesus said, love each other as I've loved you, there's no jealousy there. We rejoice when our brother or sister are blessed, or maybe are operating in a gift, or whatever the thing is. We rejoice in that when we love them. If we're secretly jealous, we really despise the fact that it happened to them. See the opposite effect? Love brings strength and connection and unity. Jealousy brings division. And think about that. If the love between mankind can be that strong, can you imagine the kind of love, the unbreakable covenant that the Lord has for us? The incredible love he has for us. His love will never leave us. His love compels him to never forsake us. And here's the thing. He will never condemn us for our sins because of his promise in the new covenant. That covenant is like a super contract. It's unbreakable. At least from God's perspective, God never breaks his covenant. And here's what he promised us. In Hebrews 10:16-17, he's quoting from Jeremiah. This is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, says the Lord. I will put my laws in their hearts, and in their minds I will write them. Then he adds, their sins and their lawless deeds I will remember no more. That's the covenant that God has with us. That's the depth of the unconditional love God has for us. So we don't have to worry about when we go to God when we're in prayer or when we're in need or we just flat need his presence to show up. We don't have to think that he's mad at us. We don't have to think that he's condemning us or judging us for our sins. The Father fully judged sin in the body of Jesus Christ and dealt with it once and for all. In fact, the Bible tells us that the power of sin is the law. And in Colossians chapter 2, it says that Jesus basically fulfilled the law, and then he nailed the ordinance of the law that was against us to the tree. In his crucifixion, Jesus fully paid the price for our sins. That's why God does not look at us with a condemnatory eye. And that's why he says this, he who knew no sin became sin, so that we could be the righteousness of God. We're not cloaked in righteousness. We are the righteousness. That's the incredible effect Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection has on us when we believe. We are transformed by God. So anyway, David leaves Jonathan and goes to Nob to see Ahimelech. He's the priest. And David does something then that he's not permitted to do. David's hungry. He asks Ahimelech, hey, you got anything to eat around here? You know, you got any Pop-Tarts, anything? And Ahimelech says, no, the only thing we have is the showbread from the temple. Now, that showbread, it was 12 loaves that represented the 12 tribes of Israel, and it was prescribed in Leviticus 24 for the tabernacle, when God gave the tabernacle design to Moses. That bread was only for the Levites to eat, the priest. David was not a priest. David came from the tribe of Judah, not from the tribe of Levi. Nevertheless, David ate the showbread. David did something that was unlawful, and even the priest did not condemn him for that. It raises an interesting question. Did David break the law? Yes, he broke the law. Jesus referenced that event. One day, he and his disciples were walking through the grain fields, and they were plucking the grain and eating it. And the Pharisees, who are always looking for Jesus to blow it, to stumble, ask him, why are your disciples breaking the law? Why are they doing this on the Sabbath? Here's what Jesus said. In Mark 2, 25 through 28, he said, have you never read what David did when he was in need and hungry? He and those with him, how he went into the house of God in the days of Abiathar, the high priest, and ate the showbread, which is not lawful to eat except for the priest, and also gave some to those who were with him. And he said to them, the Sabbath was made for man, and not man for the Sabbath. Therefore, the Son of Man is also Lord of the Sabbath. What is Jesus saying to them? God made the Sabbath for man, not the other way around. I mean, his point was this. You can follow the letter of the law and completely miss the heart of God. That's why Jesus, you know, explained to people, he said, you know, the law says that if you kill somebody, you've committed murder. But I say, if you look at a brother with anger in your heart, that you're at risk of judgment. See, Jesus was saying the real intent of the law was to show the heart of God, to get to the heart of the matter, not to do outward obeisance and outward obedience. And unfortunately, there's a lot of people that, you know, try to follow the letter of the law at the expense of themselves and others. I mean, Jesus indicted the Pharisees over and over again when they accused him of breaking the law by healing on the Sabbath. Remember the lady who had the condition where she was stooped over for 18 years? He heals her on the Sabbath, and the Pharisees are complaining about it. He calls them hypocrites. See, he knew that he even referenced, he says, well, on the Sabbath, don't you take your donkey out if it needs water and give it water? Then why are you complaining about healing a daughter of Abraham that's been afflicted by Satan these 18 years? You hypocrites. See, Jesus is revealing the heart of the law. And that's what we need to remember, as John wrote in John 1:17, he said, for the law was given through Moses. Moses was God's servant. But grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. See, the truth is, Jesus came in the flesh to die for us, to pay for the condemnation and the judgment of sin. Therefore, we've not been given judgment. We've been given grace. We've been given unmerited favor. In his mercy, he did not condemn us, because Jesus took that condemnation. What he did give us was something we didn't deserve. This is grace, unmerited favor. He gave us redemption. He purchased us from the slave market. We're no longer slaves to sin. He gave us forgiveness. We didn't earn it. Jesus paid the price for it. He gave us righteousness. He made us, turned us in from enemies of God to the righteousness of God. He gave us favor. We don't just have absolution from the tribunal. We are actually embraced by the tribunal to the point that he's given us heirship, and he's given us his spirit, who is in our hearts crying out all the time, Abba, Father. That's the kind of thing that Jesus did. That's the kind of heart of God that he wants us to concentrate on, not the outward doing of things that our hearts are not in. David understood that about God. I mean, if anybody who was pre-Jesus understood what Jesus was going to bring to the table, David seemed to understand that. He saw God's deliverance. He saw God's mercy. He saw God's grace. He not only embraced it, he constantly reminded God how grateful he was for it. And that touched God's heart to the point where he calls David a man after his own heart. It wasn't that David had the heart of God. It's that David chased after the heart of God because he saw what the heart of God was really like for those who trusted him. I mean, there was no doubt that David worshipped the Lord as God because he reads from the law that he is the Lord. But David seemed to have that connection that only Jesus brings. It's one of kinship, one of closeness, one of understanding of God's heart toward us. That understanding of that deep, unfailing, unconditional love that God has for those who trust him, who believe. So how do I know that David understood the heart of God is to forgive sin? Here's what he wrote, Psalms 32, 1 through 2. Blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord does not impute iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. Now, under the law, there was no forgiveness of sin. There was atonement for sin. But David seemed to understand the heart of God enough to recognize that in God's grace, he would forgive sin because God himself would pay the price for sin. David was considered a prophet, and I think this is a prophecy about the effects of redemption. David didn't have redemption in his time. He had atonement. Atonement was the sacrifice of the animals, right? But that never covered, that never eliminated the condemnation of sin. It just covered it for a year. In Jesus shedding his blood, that was absolute redemption. It is with his eternal divine blood, he didn't just cover our sins. He removed them from us. And he removed the condemnation and the judgment of them from us. That's why he calls us the righteousness of God. In God's eyes, we're pure. David seemed to understand that. He understood it was not about ritual and dead letter. He understood that God is about life and the things that bring the things about his life that he brings to his children. God wants us to delight in that. Unfortunately, there's a lot of us that just seem to have a hard time believing that we are blessed because God chose to forgive us and remember our sins no more. That's just hard to believe sometimes. But that's exactly the way God thinks about it. And if we could grasp that, it would be a whole lot easier to tell people in our world about the love of God when we're actually walking in a knowledge of the forgiveness, the favor, and the incredible love that God has for us, rather than waiting for us to step out of line so he could whack us with a big stick. But see, David was still human. He left Ahimelech and he escaped to King Achish of Gath, the Philistine king. Now, man, you know that you are in trouble when you go running to your enemies for protection. Because the people that David was at war with all the time were the Philistines. Goliath was a Philistine. But King Achish, he remembered the song, Saul has killed his thousands and David's killed his 10,000. Achish wouldn't have anything to do with David. Why would I bring the major foe of my army into my own camp? Well, David heard that, and David was scared. In the middle of all this trust, David was afraid. And so he started acting like a mad person and drooling at the mouth and scratching on the door. And the king's like, look, we got enough of these people around here. He's out of his mind. Get him out of here. So they basically cast him out. Ultimately, David ends up in a cave. Cave of Adullam. So from this point, David goes from a shepherd boy who was just having this close relationship with God to a giant killer to being a psalterist in Saul's house to the point that he ended up being a great high-ranking official in David's army to a fugitive in a cave. Talk about ups and downs. David had them all. And during the whole time, David knew to praise God. He knew to trust God. He knew God was faithful. He knew God would deliver him. He wasn't sure how. That's why sometimes it was afraid for him. But he never let fear dilute his trust in the Lord. What a right he had. See, David understood something. He knew that we're in a fallen world. And people are fallen. Fallen people do bad things to other people. But David always remembered that even in those situations, when the storm's coming, that he knew that the Lord could stop the storm. He knew that the Lord could take him around the storm. He knew that the Lord could take him through the storm. He knew that. He didn't know which one God was going to do. But he knew that whatever God was going to do, God was going to be with David. See, that was the kind of trust that David had in the Lord. Remember, the Lord is our refuge, our strength, our protector. He is a great help in times of trouble. And in that cave, he continued to find favor. David's in a cave and people were coming to look for him just to be around David. Those who were troubled, those who were in debt, those who were discontent, they came to join up with him. He ended up with 400 men that were loyal to him. And these don't sound like good company. People who are in debt, people who are in trouble, people who are discontented, those are the kind of people that we're taught to stay away from, right? Bad company corrupts good morals. But I guess when you're alone living in a cave, cave, any company is better than none, right? But I think this is more of a symbolism of Jesus. Who came flocking to Jesus? Was it the Pharisees? Was it the Levites? Was it the aristocracy? No. It was the poor, the outcast, the humbled, the discontented. It was those who were despised, like the tax collectors, the sinners, the prostitutes. They came flocking to Jesus. Did they corrupt Jesus? Of course not. They saw in him what we all need to see very clearly. They saw him, our great hope. That's what they saw in David. I think that's why they were flocking to him. David gave those men hope and leadership. Jesus gives us hope in every respect. I mean, that's why Paul called him our great hope. See, it's not a wishful thinking. It is a confident expectation that Jesus is going to do everything he said he's going to do, including coming back to get us. We can absolutely trust him to do that. And I think as we allow ourselves to trust, like little children, we'll find ourselves having a heart that was very much like David, somebody who's after God's heart. Let's pray. Father, help us to simply trust you more. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are your ways higher than ours. We don't always know what you're going to do, and we don't always know when you're going to do it, but we know that you're never late, and you do exactly what is needed. So we can trust you in that. So help us to rest in that trust.